I'm Kyle with the Identity and Network Access Group here at Microsoft, and in this video, I want to talk about delegated permissions. Applications often need to be authorized in order to access resource or a web API. Whenever there is a user in front of your application, you're compelled to act on behalf of that user and ask for a delegated permission, which simply means your application has a user, and the application is going to be working on behalf of that user. So you make a request to Azure AD to get an access token so that you can then access that resource. Azure AD will then turn around and see if it can answer the question of, is this application, not the user, but the application, allowed to access the resource on behalf of the user? And specifically, we're looking for questions like, has admin consent been granted for everyone effectively in this tenant by the admin? Or has this particular user, and we do know who the user is at this point, if we didn't know who the user was, we would have had the user authenticate. We ask to see if this user has already granted consent to this application. And if either one of those are yes, we can go ahead and issue the token and move on. If neither one is true, or the answer has not been specifically been prevented, then we need to go ahead and go back to the private conversation that the developer set us for us to have between Azure Active Directory and the user. This is that private conversation where we're going to go ahead and ask the user, do you consent to this application accessing this information on your behalf? So we're not talking about what the user can do. In this case, it's in fact the user who might be saying, yes, I trust this application with access to that resource. Now, to make it a little easier for both users and admins to be able to grant that request, we do have a process called publisher verification. So when an entity is publishing a multi-tenant application, they can be verified by joining the Microsoft Partner Network, where we will vet the individual or the entity and make sure they are who they claim to be. And then once they mark their application as coming from a verified publisher partner of us with the Microsoft and the Microsoft Partner Network, they'll go ahead and get the blue check mark, which shows that this application is in fact being published by a verified publisher. This will help your application get adoption, as it gives your customers and these users a sense of security that at least Microsoft has a business relationship with the entity asking for this consent. Now, when an admin is at this at this point in the application, they'll get a slightly different experience. They'll get a checkbox here in the consent dialog, where they can consent on behalf of the organization, meaning no one else in this tenant will ever be prompted for this consent again because they're here as an admin applying admin consent. If they leave the box unchecked, then they can go ahead and use the application themselves, but no one else in the tenant has gotten consent yet, so they will be denied if they're not an admin. So once consent is granted, if consent is denied, of course, we will not return the token to the application, and the application will need to handle that situation gracefully. But as long as the consent has been granted, we will create an access token that includes in that access token claims that identify the user to the API. We'll go ahead and return that access token to the application that asked for it, and then the application will make its call to the API and provide that access token to the API, and now the API knows exactly what the application has been granted with respect to the permission it requested in the scope parameter of that token, and it knows who the user is because of the user information in the claims as well, and of course it knows that it has come from Azure AD and not been tampered with because the API will validate the token, validate the signing signature, and so on. Now, it's important that the user identity is in that token. We can't trust the application to simply claim they're working on behalf of a particular user. We get that information directly from Azure AD. And this is important because when we have a delegated permission, there are two components at play. First off, what permission has the application been granted through the process that we just looked at around permission and consent? So we have granted what permissions the application is allowed to do. At the same time, we have identified the user to the API. So the API can go to whatever other system they use to determine what each user is allowed to do, and they know who the user is and what the user is allowed to do, and who the application is and what the application is allowed to do. And then the API will take the intersection of those two and decide how the application will actually work. So we refer to this as effective permission. So just because we might give an application, say, user.readwrite.all, which is a very powerful permission, but in the hands of a regular user, it doesn't allow a regular user to update someone else's profile. In the hands of a tenant admin or a user admin, yes, that application is trusted, that it does the right things with respect to whenever it allows an admin user to go ahead and make those changes. So just because the application has been granted permission doesn't mean the user can do that. And just because the user may have the ability to do an operation doesn't mean the application can if it also hasn't been given a matching capability or scope in the consent process. So your application is always bound with a delegated permission to what the user can do as well, which we refer to as these effective permissions. And then finally, the developer can actually control when they go ahead and ask for these consents. We do strongly suggest that developers do put in their app registration all of the APIs and the permissions that they are going to use. That way, a tenant admin can look at that, decide that that this is okay with them, and pre-consent for the entire organization. But technically, we don't necessarily look at that app registration during the process I just described. We wait for the application to request a particular consent, a permission. We call that a dynamic permission. So as I start my application, maybe I ask for a couple of permissions, and I might do additional ones incrementally or even statically. So let's look at those three options. Dynamic consent is the default. So here, for example, my application is asking for user.read and people.read. So here, when I first start the application, I see sign in and read your profile, as well as read your relevant people list. Now, my IT pro can go to the Enterprise App Blade, find my application, see the permissions that the application has been granted, and even see which users have granted that consent so far. So this is our standard dynamic consent, and we don't actually reference any APIs that might be in the application registration. Now, sometimes developers want a permission that doesn't necessarily make sense at the first tier of when the application first starts. So maybe that application we just looked at is asked to sign in the user and read their profile and look at their relevant people list. And it's not till later on in the application where it says, would you like me to get that information from your OneDrive, that the reason for asking permission to read their user's OneDrive makes sense to the user. This can help drive adoption or getting that consent for the application by being able to really give the user a sense of comfort as the reason I'm granting this, for example, files.read consent is because I want the application to access my OneDrive. So this can help the acceptability of your consent requests by combining your dynamic permission request, which you did at the start of your application, with incrementally adding more as the user discovers or goes to additional capabilities within your application. And then the final experience is what we refer to as static consent. In this case, the developer uses the .default scope. When they use .default, so they say perhaps Microsoft Graph.default or application.default scope, we go ahead and do look at the app registration and see which permissions, say from Microsoft Graph, have been declared and granted to that application already. And if they have not yet been granted consent, but they are declared in the app registration, then we would add those and say, well, we need to get these additional permissions consented. But we go and look at what's in the app registration, do what I sometimes like to refer to as permissions math, and then present the user with the permissions that the application is asking for. So static consent does, in fact, go back to the application registration, but the developer must use the .default scope to get there. So delegated permissions authorize an application to access a resource, but only on behalf of the signed-in user. So every action will actually be limited to both what the application can do and what the user has permission to do. They can be granted either by a regular user in some cases, or always by an admin. Be aware as a developer that even though you might read the docs and it says that it's a user-consentable permission, admins can override that and require admin consent for absolutely everything, should they so desire. And finally, remember, you control when the user gets prompted for these permissions, and it may help your application's adoption if you ask for the permissions on an effectively just-in-time or incremental basis, because then the user would understand why your application needs that particular permission. Thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.